Am I audible, sir?
Yeah. There was some problem a moment before, so I had to reconnect. I don't
Yeah,
know what, but
no problem, sir. No problem. Sir, if you check your presentation by sharing the screen.
Yeah, I'll check it right now. Oops. So is it visible?
No, sir. Now it's coming.
Now it's okay.
Not yet, but it's showing that you have started. Yeah, perfect, sir. Visible now.
It's visible now.
Yes. Sir, I'll take you half a minute for the introduction. Yeah, and then so very good of good morning, everyone. We have with us Dr. Prem Prakash Yadav, who is a principal scientist at Division of Medicinal and Process Chemistry at CDRI, and he did his MSc in chemistry from University of Allahabad during 2001, and from the same subject he did PhD under the mentorship of Rakesh Maurya from CSIR CDRI, and the topic was phytochemical investigation of medicinal plants and chemical transformation of bioactive natural products. And he was a postdoc fellow at Institute of Organic and Biomolecular Chemistry at Germany during 2008 to 2009. And he is working with CDRI since 2005. So you can imagine the vast experience he has working with CDRI and on the phytochemicals. His group is mainly involved in the identification of bioactive compounds through medicinal chemistry approaches and development of novel strategies for the synthesis of medicinally active heterocycles. So he is also awarded with that postdoctoral fellowship during 2008, and there are a number of publications on his name in reputed international and national journals with high impact factor. So I'm not going to take his much of time. With this, I'm inviting you, sir. I'm very pleased to invite you on behalf of Srishti. Very warm welcome, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Megha, for such a nice introduction. And I'm pleased to actually deliver this webinar, which is meant to enlighten research aptitude in young minds, and I'm very much happy to see so many people join over there. And I'm really thankful to Srishti to initiate this effort in under this Biotech Innovation Ignition School to inculcate these research principles at early steps and early life of these young minds, and so that they can get into the real picture of research which is going around in country as well as whole world. And this will enable them to decide how to take things forwards and what they are willing to pursue in their future, and shall there be any topic of interest to them from our lectures, I think they will be benefited, and we'll be definitely there to help any future needs which arises out of these lectures and all. If they are interested, they can definitely contact us for any further help.
Right.
And you may not know, but I have been associated with Srishti before also in one project where we had isolation of microbial natural products, a project from DBT, where DST, from where, in which Srishti was involved in the collection of microbial strains.
Soil samples, right?
Yeah, soil samples, and INTEC was involved in culture, and CDRI was involved in isolation of biotic components. But somehow that project didn't lead to too exciting results. But of course, we had learned so many things out of that project, and life is all about learning.
Right.
So we are still learning.
Yeah.
Okay. So good morning to all of you once again. And as you know, I am at CSIR, Central Drug Research Institute in Lucknow, and I'm basically a medicinal chemist who looks upon medicinal chemistry space, and we always look at nature for any sort of inspiration. So here also for drug discovery, we are looking forward to nature to inspire us, and it has been wonderful inspiration throughout, and nature has always been an inspiration, and you will see in some of my slides how it has helped evolve drug discovery pipelines. So I chose this topic, phytochemicals and plant-based drug discovery, because it is my basic focus area of research, and I would be more comfortable to give you more insight into this topic. Apart from these efforts on plant-based molecules discovery, we also work on medicinal chemistry aspects of diversified natural product compounds, and that I will not be touching upon in today's talk, but that also. So when we talk about phytochemicals and its relation to drug discovery, so I think the slides are in show mode or not?
Yes, sir, it's visible completely.
Okay, so if we think how human civilizations have treated themselves and kept themselves healthy from the very early life on earth, and answer is only natural products. So most of the ancient and medieval people, they rely on Ayurveda, Egyptian medicine, Babylonian medicine, Chinese medicine, then Yunani and medieval medicines came later on. So they evolved over the time. So this science has not come out today. This science has evolved through evolution of humans. Evolution on Earth led to this evolution also. So this knowledge has been evolved and documented in several texts and being practiced by major populations. Later on, when around 19th century or so, we began to realize importance of single components or chemical entities. And that's the time when people started to focus on single component medicines, and we started to isolate them, purify them, characterize them, and then analyze them for their potential benefits, and then we develop them into new drugs. And we get inspiration from those structures. So 21st century, there has been significant change in our approach to drug discovery, and it has majorly dependent on target-based drugs, screening large library of synthetic and natural product compounds, nanomedicines, delivery systems. Then came this phytopharmaceuticals, botanical drugs, nutraceuticals, and targeted therapies. So these are the current trends in approaches which we follow in drug discovery. But there are certain challenges which always led this drug discovery to evolve. And today's challenges are drug resistance towards major antibiotics, antiparasitics, anti-cancer medicine. And it's not only resistance, actually we have different kinds of diseases, like lifestyle diseases, diseases which are not caused by any pathogen. They are caused by our lifestyle changes, which we have adopted over the year. So earlier people used to live in beneath sun, with nature. Now we are living in a nature which is created by ourselves, in environments which is man-made. So most of the time we don't spend in natural environment. We spend most of the time in our own created environment of air-conditioned rooms and all. We don't see too much of sunlight. So these all created a lot of diseases, and this is again a challenge. And these lifestyle diseases are taking the stage now onward. Likewise, we have developed CNS disorders, which again is because, maybe broadly because of our lifestyle changes and use of several medications. Apart from these aspects, challenges also towards affordability of medicines by major population. So majority of population in countries like India, Africa, and other Southeast Asian countries, they live in quite poverty line, in near poverty line conditions. So affordability of most of the drugs is not met to them. So we need to tackle this challenge also. We have to make these drugs affordable. And one more challenge is coming around is drug regulations. So you must have, I think everybody has got to know about drug regulations these days because of corona pandemic. We know that a vaccine development, how it takes phase 1, 2, 3 clinical trials, then healthy volunteers, non-healthy volunteers, disease volunteers, then side effects, and all these needs to be taken care of. And these drug regulations are also challenging to attain and challenging to complete in stipulated time. And that's why once this time of development increases, obviously we are going to increase the cost of production, cost of manufacturing, cost of discovery, And this cost is ultimately going to be borne by the individuals, because companies are, they are not going to bear that cost. So they will calculate every single penny spent on that development, and this will be charged to prospective patients. And so this is going to hamper affordability to masses. So these are few challenges which led to holistic approaches gaining more importance in today's drug discovery programs. So if you see how we start a drug discovery program in today's world, so we start with drug target identification and validation. So chemical biology target identification and validations occur. Molecular understanding of biological targets takes place. Then chemistry methods are applied, enzyme pathways, synthetic biology, synthesis of compounds, isolation of compounds based on particular target. Like you must have seen in case of COVID-19, we have so many targets to be target for viral entry and so on. So all these targeted targets are being pursued, and people are working around the globe to identify potential hits against those targets. And some of them, they are well-validated targets. So because of SARS-1, they have been identified and validated too much. So there is plenty of information to vouch on their search. That's why people are going forward with those targets. So screening nature product libraries against those targets led to several new chemical scaffolds identified as antivirals acting against COVID, and they are under development. So this is the first step where we discover hits. Like say we say that a compound is biologically active, then hit compounds, they have activity around 10 micromolar or so. In case of natural products, they may be directly drugs. You can directly use those compounds as drugs because they have efficacy sufficiently enough to be used as drugs. For synthetic libraries, we stick to relaxed criteria. At these stages, when in vitro screening is done, so around 10 micromolar compounds are good enough. Then we follow up these hits regarding their diversification, potential modifications, or larger library, focused library screening around those scaffolds. And then we identify selective and nanomolar active molecules suitable for in vivo studies. Suitable for in vivo studies, this suitability is based on pharmacokinetic parameters. So once we know that certain compounds, they are stable in our gut conditions, in our oral conditions, and they are not metabolized by our liver enzymes and all, and they are stable, then we think of moving ahead with lead optimization. Lead optimization is nothing but playing around certain scaffold. Say it is a natural product, then we have to have strategies like we can functionalize, derivatize, and mask, unmask different parts of that molecule to attain optimum activity, optimum oral exposure. And if at all, if oral exposure or there are some problems at these stages, formulation, pharmaceutics people, they are engaged over here to develop novel formulations for targeted delivery of those components or stability of those components, oral bioavailability of those compounds. And then a preclinical candidate is selected for further development, and preclinical safety, efficacy, and toxicity studies are done under from a GMP manufactured product under GLP conditions, which led to IND submission. Investigational new drug submissions are done, and then authorities decide upon a regulatory approval for to conduct clinical trials. So this is a typical pathway, typical flowchart. Most of the drug discovery flow follows slightly modified or exactly these flows. So if we see success rate versus time in drug discovery, so you can see that at the discovery stage, so in the previous slide you have seen these are hit discovery and target identification, and these are actually these initial phases are actually our discovery phases where we discover hits, and then these are actually development phases. Later part of this flow is development phase. So you see, discovery phase, we spend around 4 years of time on an average, and around 10,000 molecules are being tested. Followed by preclinical trials, it takes around 3 years, and around 250 molecules are undergo these preclinical trials. Then out of these 250 molecules, around 5 molecules reach to the clinical trials stage, and after regulatory review in 1 year or so, one new drug is made available. So around 10,000 molecules we start with, and we reach to one drug candidate. So global average cost is around $2.5 billion, and time is around 12 to 14 years to develop a single new drug. And in Corona time, you must have seen that this time has been drastically decreased, because here in what we can do is that if we have already approved drugs, if we have already clinically approved drugs, they have already crossed these stages of development. They might have completed clinical trials, preclinical trials, drug discovery phases. So all these phases are met out. And only because efficacy, safety, and toxicity has already been established. So you have to conduct only phase 3 trials and then go for regulatory review and approvals. So that's how most of these drugs have been approved in recent past for COVID-19. They are actually called repurposing. Repurposing means they have been used for some other indication earlier, and they have been, they are now used for the current indication in question. So there has been several approaches for drug discovery, you have seen. So what has led to this paradigm shift in discovery programs? That we have started rationally designing our molecules is because of increased power of computer. Structural biology strengths have been strengthened because of crystallographic developments. Then we have changed attention from random screening or random searches to rational computer-aided drug design. However, these approaches also are little successful. Some of the rationally designed drugs are in pipeline and approved. However, this has also severe limitations. One further development was high throughput screenings, where you can screen large number of molecular library and screen them in high throughput manner to minimize time to identify hit molecules. But problem is that these libraries, they are mostly focused libraries. And to generate combinatorial libraries, it's again not covering that much of chemical space. So despite these problems, these high throughput screening systems are very useful to filter down molecules and to initiate a drug discovery. So, utmost challenge is to attain chemical diversity. Chemical diversity means number of different chemicals, chemical scaffolds covering whole chemical landscape, whole possible chemical landscape. Okay, so to meet out these challenges, natural products are a must studied materials. So this slide compares about likeliness of natural products to be drugs, and it compares your combinatorial library of compounds and library of FDA approved drugs. So what it says is that chemical diversity spaces of drugs and natural products are more similar, they are more aligned as compared to very focused libraries of combinatorial compounds. So combinatorial compounds may mimic certain parts of natural products and their libraries, but drugs, they spare in a very different space, and natural products mostly mimic that space. So what happened after antibiotics, a lot of antibiotics have been discovered during 60s, 70s and all. So people have realized that we have enough antibiotics and we don't need any more antibiotics. And that's how these natural products research have gained, have started to decline. And people have realized that most of the chemical space have been covered and we are done with it. We don't have much left to do in natural products. And that's how natural products research has declined in the past. And now it is accelerated, and we are seeing a big jump in natural product-based research. It's because of their properties, their value. And in a recent review by David Newman and Craig, see that around 60% of small molecule new chemical entities introduced as drugs worldwide during 81 to 2014 can be traced to natural products. And this is how they are dispersed. Means natural products around 6%, their derivatives around 20%, synthetic compounds with pharmacophores derived from natural products around 13%, natural product mimics, synthetic compounds, around 14%. And there is one more new class of botanical drugs which is coming up. There are 6-7 botanicals approved in US FDA, and some of the phytopharmaceuticals are yet to be approved by DCGI in India. This is again the same plot you can see here. This is Nature Botanicals. And B, these are the botanical products which are not single component medicines. So around 91% of whole approved drugs. These are natural product derivatives. These are natural products as such. They are being used, inspired from natural product pharmacophores, NMR, natural product mimetics. So they mostly in a combination, you can see that around 60% of these drugs can be traced to natural products. There is an interesting concept of reverse pharmacology coming around. And this term was actually coined by Dr. Patwardhan. And it's a very interesting to notice that traditional knowledge is actually well validated clinical observation. If you see, it's a clinical observation which is being practiced by communities. So these clinical observations can be tapped in a reverse pharmacology fashion, where our clinical results will guide us to deliver products. So we have knowledge about clinical means mass use of those Ayurvedic Siddha Yunani system of medicines, and those medicines can again be tested in experimental observations, experimental models in the lab, and then they can be further evaluated or validated to reach the regulatory authorities. So this is a flowchart which says that actually medicinal plants from field use to standardized extracts utilizing reverse pharmacology approaches, so they can be standardized to get Ayush medicines, these extracts. As such, if you use extracts of certain plant materials or preparations from certain natural sources, they can be used as Ayush medicines. Then Ayush Siddha Yunani medicines according to their original use. If you come up with isolated active compounds, you can use them as NCEs. And if we optimize these bioactive extract or their fractions, and we standardize them with active components, and then do further clinical research, experimental observations and clinical trials, these will lead to phytopharmaceuticals. So this is what I have already talked about. But the only one thing which I wanted to emphasize in this slide is that it's we are moving away from one target, one drug approach, because we know that disease is a manifestation of disease is a holistic manifestation on human body. So it's not like lifestyle diseases are multi-targeted. There are multiple factors involved in disease progression. So tackling one of them may lead to certain other side observations or side effects. So now if we start thinking about multi-target therapy, and if we start thinking about multiple combinations targeting certain diseases, so this is what holistic system of medicine is actually. Because what we do is that our traditional system of medicines is actually directed towards activation of defense, protective and repair mechanisms of the body, rather than killing or damaging other organs or cells. Okay, so one example is curcumin, which has multi-targeted effects in cancer regression, anti-carcinogenic, carcinogenic, pro-apoptotic, angiogenic, metastatic, immunomodulating, antioxidant. When you combine these all benefits, they are going to be more effective. However, once you isolate the active components of curcumin, like curcuminoids, they are secondary metabolites present in curcumin in major amount. So these curcuminoids have not sufficient bioavailability. So to enhance sufficient bioavailability, again, people are making formulations, nano formulations. But you know, in traditional system, we take haldi with milk. So haldi with milk, what it makes is a nano emulsion. And we take nano emulsion actually when we drink milk with haldi. So this slide is just to emphasize this point. So these are all chronological developments in traditional medicine literature. You can see Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, then Athar Veda, Charak Samhita, Sushruta Samhita, Asanga Haridra, Siddha Privedic, Yunani, Chinese traditional system of medicine. So they all document this traditional knowledge, and they all have a plethora of documentary preparations to be used for the communities. So these are certain trends in isolation of active compounds. So you see morphines, emetine, colchicine, quinine, atropine, cocaine, ephedrine. These were the initial components which were isolated from these plants. However, their structures were elucidated later on. So morphine was isolated before, but its structure was not known at the time when it was isolated. It was elucidated later on by the advent of several chemical tools.
Hello, sir.
Yeah. Hello.
Sorry for interruption, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, you just told us, sir, haldi and sir milk made emulsion, but sir, it's make as a suspension, no, sir. Because sir, solid particle dispersed in the liquid medium is called as a suspension. So I'm right, sir?
Yeah. Suspension.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Carry on, sir.
So like we take aspirin is a life-saving drug, you know, and it was isolated from this plant, not aspirin, but salicin. You can see this benzyl alcohol and phenol moiety with this sugar attached to it. So phenolic glycoside with the benzylic alcohol moiety. So this is what salicin is. So salicin was isolated from this plant's Salix alba willow tree, and this plant was used to alleviate pain for many years. So its infusion was used to treat fever, pain, and inflammatory conditions. Later on, this was isolated and characterized. They found that when isolated, this compound was not that stable, so they modified it to salicylic acid and acetylated it to make it more stable, acetyl salicylic acid, which is prodrug of salicylic acid. And it is marketed and it's a blockbuster drug, which cannot be replaced as of now. However, if it would have been discovered today, it may not get an approval because of its too many pleiotropic effects. But still, it is a life-saving drug for most of the cardiac patients. Likewise, you see quinine antimalarial principle was isolated from bark of cinchona, and which led to mefloquine and several other related quinoline class of compounds. 4 aminoquinolines were also tested, because 4 aminoquinolines were earlier used as dyes. So they were tested just because of being quinolines towards killing of malaria parasite. And then they identified aminoquinolines to be effective, and they are being used. But in today's time, they have been restricted to ACTs and they have developed resistance. So new anti-malarial are needed, and that's where most of the research in malaria drug discovery is going on, to identify new prototype molecules which can affect multiple life cycle stages of malaria parasite, and which is having fast killing as well as which is clearing all the parasite, but even from the liver stage, because liver stage infection in P. vivax malaria is a problem. So these all discoveries initiated from this plant, cinchona, and this compound, quinine. Next is interesting antimalarial compound is artemisinin. So Artemisia annua led to isolation of this compound, and it's a sesquiterpene lactone, and 1-4 trioxane moiety is actual pharmacophore in this molecule. And later on, people have utilized, even in CDRI also, we have two clinical candidates, 99/411 and 97/78. These two compounds, they are being studied for clinical trials. They are based on these 1-4 trioxane scaffold, and actually that scaffold is inspired from artemisinin 1-4 trioxane, and its mechanism of heme alkylation is well known, and actually this part is involved in killing the parasite. And this compound led to Nobel Prize in 2015 to Professor Yu Tu of China for her contribution to discovery of artemisinin. And she was not known before this Nobel Prize, but after that, she is a well-known person. And you will be surprised to know that the malaria project, which was running in China, they had screened thousands of plants to isolate components regarding anti-malarial active compounds. And this lady screened around 500, 600 plants, and she was reading traditional literature. And what she could find that in traditional Chinese system of medicine, people have used cold percolation to isolate, to make preparations of this Artemisia annua plant. They have not used boiling in water or something like that conditions to isolate, to make preparations of this plant to treat fever and malaria. So she inspired from those literature, and what she has observed in lab, that activities were not consistent. So she could get sometimes better activity and other times activity is lost, because they were isolating, they were making extract in ethanol with the boiling conditions. So ethanol at 78 degrees Celsius, you boil and then you get this trioxane moiety degraded. So it's heat sensitive moiety. Then she changed this to ether. 35 degrees Celsius, ether is used, boiling point is there. So ether is most suitable solvent to extract these compounds, because they were lipophilic also, and ether has a low boiling point, so they may not be degraded also. And this led to this Nobel Prize. This only change in the approach to isolate these compounds led to discovery of this compound, and she could show that this compound was 100% efficacious in killing the parasite burden in monkey model, which led to this discovery as well as Nobel Prize maybe 30-40 years back later, but of course it matters. So in natural products, changing conditions to only this extent may lead to major breakthrough. So traditional practices have relevance in this regard, because they have evolved throughout ages, and these practices are actually guiding to isolate active person. So next example in this in is anti-cancer podophyllotoxins, Podophyllum palatum. You can see these are lignan compounds, and this was the major compound isolated from this plant. And this is the glycoside, however it was a minor compound, it was active. So what people did is that they isolated this major compound and prepared synthetically these glycosides, modified glycoside, and these two adipocytes and tenipocytes, they are used for testicular cancer, lung cancer, and lymphomas. Similarly, camptothecin, it was also isolated, however, it was poorly water soluble in isolated form. So again, Camptotheca acuminata was Chinese plant, and it was used to treat cancer. So this compound was isolated, and poor solubility issue was later on rectified by installing this linker moiety, And this derivative RNO tecon is used for lung and ovarian and cervical cancer. Vinca rosea, well-known plant. You must find this plant in your gardens, growing wild. So this wind blasting and wind cresting compounds were isolated from this plant and for the treatment of Hodgkin's disease and leukemia, respectively. It's a well-known plant, Taxus brevifolia, which delivers this Taxol, the much-discussed anti-cancer compound, which didn't only led to treatment of several patients suffering from cancer, but it also led to a new mechanistic understanding in cancer field, where microtubule depolymerization was studied based on, was discovered based on these anti-cancer molecules. These are terpenoids, and one of the compound 10 days dalbecatin was isolated in more amount from the needles of this plant, and then it was transformed to install this side chain containing this tersibutoxy group, which improved solubility also. And this is actually commercially used, Taxotere, as a brand name of Taxotere, and these are commercially used to treat cancers. So up till now, I have discussed very exciting natural products derived from plants. So to give you a glimpse of how natural products are important, but they are not only observed in plants. So you can find them in all the natural resources. However, those resources have not been explored too much, or they are now being explored too much because of the difficult conditions in the marine environment per se. Like if you have to explore marine habitat, it needs a special vessel to go down deep the sea, deep at the bottom of the sea, and collect the samples, bring them to the lab conditions. And most of these samples, they don't survive in the lab conditions. So they have to be maintained in high pressure, high salinity conditions, and grown under those conditions. So it's a very challenging task, but they have been utilized to deliver drugs. And some of the examples you can see over here is spongoiridine and spongothymidine, which led to vadadustine antiviral drugs. So it was isolated from this sponge. Likewise, giconotide is a peptide, which was isolated from cone snail. This cone snail poisons fishes. So it releases a poison, and this poison paralyzes fishes, and then it catches those fishes as its food. So it's a natural mechanism for this snail survival, because it has to make very effective venom to paralyze a fish in sea. Because once it is released from cone snail's sting, it has to be diluted n number of times in seawater. So it has to be very much effective. And that's what it is. So you can see it is around 100 to 1000 times more potent than morphine. So Prialt is the name of this drug. However, it is having disulfide linkages, and its use is very limited. Again, a very fascinating compound from C-squirt, Actinicidia turbinata. This is a DNA alkylating agent. This is again approved recently. You can see this is three isoquinoline moieties are linked, fused with 1-cysteine over here. And it gives a very unique characteristic to this molecule to be acting as DNA alkylating agent. One more example is helichondrin, where you can see this helichondrin B structure was isolated from marine sponge, and then it was synthesized. This polyether antibiotic, polyether moiety was synthesized in lab. However, this fragment was found to be very effective when tested in lab conditions, and this is developed as halavine by SI Japan. So this is a synthetic drug based on your helichondrin B natural product. It's a potent antiproliferative agent. This is a visual delight, actually. This is a poison, but if you see this structure, this is a polyether natural product or polyether compound isolated from this Ciguatera fish, which is actually causing poisoning, and coral reef poisoning is because of this fish. And this is the compound which is responsible for this coral reef poisoning. Okay, so this compound is, you can see its LD50 is around 50 nanogram per kg. And you can see sodium cyanide LD50 and strychnine LD50, which are highly poisonous or highly toxic substances. Here, challenge is that it has asymmetry. So people started synthesizing this compound in lab, but the group said later on that they could not complete the synthesis after, I think, 14 years of their effort. They could not complete synthesis of this molecule because of lack of fund and other things, challenges, and they gave up this molecule. However, portions of this molecule have been synthesized. So it's not a visual delight to see such a big molecule. However, it's a challenge to synthetic chemists to synthesize them in lab conditions. It's not only these organisms. You can see animals also can inspire us with their chemical components. This frog, Ecuadorian frog skin, it gives you this compound epibetadine. And this epibetadine is excellent analgesic compound. And one of these compound, ABT-594, was identified based on the scaffold of this epibetadine, which went to some clinical trial developments. However, later on it was dropped. So we have discussed so much chemical diversity, and now we will see how sustainable supply of these natural products can be achieved. So if you have to get artemisinin today, you need to rely on plants, Artemisia annua only, because synthesis of artemisinin is not cost effective. So how we can achieve that sustainability? It's again a area of research, and that sustainability can be achieved by several other ways listed over here, by chemical means, total synthesis, semi-synthesis, USAR and further modifications, biological methods. You can have metabolite production. You can study metabolite production at molecular level. You can isolate enzymes. You can prepare recombinants and then use them. Use the engineer organisms to produce those metabolites. Plant tissue culture and cell cultures of associated microbes and invertebrate host can also deliver sustainable products of these natural products. And I have few examples for you. This is the one, trabectedin. We have just few slides back, we have seen this isoquinoline, fused isoquinoline compound, which is now in market in the name of Yondelis. And this compound, 1 gram of compound was isolated from 1 metric ton of ascidian biomass, C squared. So you have to harvest 1 metric ton of this C squared to get 1 gram of this compound. So for the whole requirement of this compound, you will destroy all the ecosystem. So to meet these challenges, scientists at this PharmaMar company in Spain, they isolated one compound, cyanocyphrosine B, from Pseudomonas fluorescens bacteria. And then they synthetically modified this compound to trabectedin or yondelis in few synthetic steps. And that's how this compound came into the market. So bacteria can produce this advanced intermediate, and this advanced intermediate can further be used to synthesize this final drug molecule. In case of artemisinin, I told you that if you rely only on natural source, what will happen? You will exhaust artemisia plant, and this is what is happening. So artemisinin cost is being regulated by China only, China and Vietnam. We are getting most of the artemisinin supplies from China. So whole world is dependent on China towards artemisinin supply. So to control prices and to make it more sustainable, more affordable for the whole world, it is required to have new processes. And you see, this is an engineered Saccharomyces cerevisiae. Baker's yeast was developed, where these biosynthetic enzymes were engineered to deliver this farnesyl pyrophosphate, and amorphadiene synthase was constructed to deliver this amorphadiene, which was then converted into artemisinic acid by these enzymes. So in short, we can synthesize artemisinic acid from this engineered Baker's yeast, and this artemisinic acid can be further used in three to four steps synthesis of artemisinin. So this is one way which is being used now. And here you can see the fermentation titer is around 25 grams per liter of artemisinin. So we can get 25 grams of artemisinic acid from 1 liter of fermentation broth for this Saccharomyces cerevisiae. That's too good to achieve. So in near future, we may not need to depend on artemisinin supply from plants. So this is so far about these plant-based and different sources of natural products. Building blocks, I would like to tell you something about how these components are being built. I will not go into the detail. So you must have read about acetyl coenzyme A pathway, succinate pathway, mevalonate pathway, deoxyxylose phosphate pathway. So you see, very limited stock of building blocks creates such a huge diversity of chemicals around us. So you see, this one slide covers most of them. So you see our fundamental processes of photosynthesis, glycolysis, Krebs cycle, they are all delivering us these key starting materials for secondary metabolism. Okay, so we see, you can see that succinic acid from phosphoenolpyruvate, deoxyxylose 5-phosphate from pyruvic acid, acetyl coenzyme A from end product of glycolysis, then these amino acids, then erythrose phosphate, succinate, then your Krebs cycle products, mevalonic acid from acetyl coenzyme A, which is again this mevalonate pathway diverse from here onwards. So accordingly, we have different class of natural products based on their starting substrates. So acetate, utilization of acetate delivers different set of compounds. Mevalonate delivers different set of compounds. Succinate delivers different set of compounds. And likewise, amino acids deliver different set of alkaloids and others. So this is important to know. So from acetyl coenzyme A pathway to yes, we have secondary metabolites like phenols, prostaglandins, macrolide antibiotics, fatty acids. So they are all delivered from this acetyl coenzyme A pathway. And some of the very representative compounds you can see over here, the Cassia angustifolia, that is Senna. So senocytes are being isolated from these plants and they are actually laxative. They are being used very frequently. So these compounds, they are derived from acetate pathway. Terpenophenolics, like your cannabinols. So cannabinols has been revisited and governments have started giving clearance to their research and medical use again, because they were banned items earlier, but due to mechanistic understandings of how these cannabinoids can be very useful in pain and several other diseases. So especially these tetrahydrocannabinols. So plants have been engineered or modified genetically to deliver selective metabolites to which has beneficial effects. So varieties of cannabis are being pursued. Next, cicumate pathways, you must have seen most ubiquitously present gallic acid is one of the cicumate metabolites. Podophyllotoxins, which I have told you earlier, they are cicumate. Lignans, all the lignans, they are cicumate derived products. Sorrelins means coumarins, flavonoids, isoflavonoids. There are flavonolignans, which are all derived from cicumate pathways. Mevalonic acid pathway, mevalonate pathway. Here, there are two pathways, mevalonate pathway and deoxyribose phosphate pathway. They both deliver isopentanyl pyrophosphate and dimethylhalide pyrophosphate. They are being used in the biosynthesis of esterides, terpenes. It's again a big class of natural product. So these are mevalonate derived precursors like monoterpene, hemiterpene, monoterpene, sesquiterpene, diterpenes, then phytoenes. So these are some of the representatives like cytosterols, mostly appearing in plants, cholesterol, animal cholesterol, then vitamin D3, folic acid, and azadirachtin. So these are all, this is a modified triterpene. Folic acid is a very unique component with all alpha hydroxyl functions, which gives its hydrophobic and hydrophilic both character. So it has two phases where you have, and by virtue of this this orientation, it gives that emulsifying nature. There are building blocks based on amino acids. So you have many alkaloids, which are derived out of several of these amino acids. Now I'll tell you in brief about how we can achieve extraction of these components from these plant materials. So say in morning we are drinking tea, we boil water, we add osimum leaves, tulsi leaves, we add some lemongrass, we add some ginger, make extract and we drink it. This is actually extraction. So extraction depends on what you are going to extract. So likewise, if you want to extract something which has polar components or which has components which are polar components which are effective, or you will use water-based extraction medium only. But sometimes you don't, water soluble components are not bioactive, then other components are bioactive. Or if you identify that, if you know that there are components which are not water soluble, which are effective, you can move ahead from water to other non-polar solvent. However, some of these solvents, they are recommended to be used, and some of them, they are not recommended to be used in Ayurvedic system of medicine. So if you are preparing, if you are thinking of an Ayurvedic preparation, you have only water and ethanol recommended to be used. For phytopharmaceuticals, you can use other solvents also. However, there are limits of impurities which has to be defined. Phytopharmaceuticals is regulated similarly as that of your single component medicine. Okay, so maceration is just extraction or whisking at room temperature, shaking at room temperature, and then filtering it out. Percolation is most commonly used. You dip your material to be extracted in a solvent and then keep it. Or sometimes repeat this process until exhaustive extraction achieves. Countercurrent extraction, where extracting material is extracted by liquid phase falling against this material. Hot continuous extraction, that is succillation. Here a refluxing solvent is used. So all the labile compounds may be degraded. So it's not used frequently if you are you don't know what components you are going to target. So for studies where you don't know what is effective, what is not effective, what is stable, what is not stable, in those studies you need to extract them by percolation or maceration or extraction techniques which are not harsh. Means high pressure and temperature you cannot apply for those extractions. Like extraction with cold and boiling water is infusion and decoction. Steam distillation for volatile oils. Most of these essential oils are being distilled and used. Electro-discharge and ultrasonic extraction methods, they are also used, but they have very limited scope. So some more recent extraction techniques like microwave-assisted extraction. So localized heating is done at molecular level by microwave. So they are used to rupture those cells and release secondary metabolites into the your solvent of extraction. Accelerated solvent extraction, where pressure, elevated pressure and temperature is used to accelerate this extraction process. Supercritical fluid, like supercritical carbon dioxide, is most favorable supercritical fluid used for supercritical fluid extraction with temperatures and critical pressure suitable to be achieved. However, they need specialized conditions, specialized equipments to be used for these extractions. Once you have extract, what you want is that you want water soluble components, you want medium polarity components, you want low polarity components. So you want to find out which component is actually effective. So to achieve that, you need to fractionate them. Like you know, petroleum products, they are being fractionated by fractional distillation. You get coal tar, you get petrol, you get benzene, you get most of these things that they are being fractionally distilled and purified. So likewise, you want all these components in that plant material or studied subjected material, you want to segregate them based on their some or other property. So you can achieve it by solvent based methods, where you use two immiscible solvents to segregate components in to separate those components in those two phases, and then separate them by separating funnel. Or you can use chromatographic methods, like column chromatographic methods, where you have a solid support and you run with an eluent and isolate with the gradient of eluent to achieve fractionation. So likewise, you can use GC is mostly used to analyze volatile components. Gas liquid chromatography is used. And then if you have your mobile phase and stationary phase, like if you have your mobile phase gas, it is called gas chromatography. If you have mobile phase liquid, it is called LC, like HPLC, and SFC is also used. So supercritical carbon dioxide is also used as a mobile phase, where you have a solid stationary phase and solid or liquid immobilized on solid stationary phase, where there you can use supercritical food size mobile phase. So based on mechanism of separation, like adsorption chromatography or polar and ionic compounds, you can use silica gel, alumina, basic alumina, neutral alumina, acidic alumina for adsorption-based chromatographic separation. Partition, it's normal solvent-based partition. You can achieve, or you can achieve a reverse phase, like you know, a reverse phase column chromatography is done, where liquid immobilized solids is used as stationary phase, and then polar mobile phase is used. Here, separation is just reversed to adsorption chromatography principle, because here separation is based on partition method. Ion exchange, if you want to separate ions, anions, cations, you have different kinds of cationic and anionic resins, bond phases, which lead to separation of these ions. Like in case of alkaloids, you make their salts and then separate them via ion exchange chromatography. Size exclusion is actually sieving through porous matrix, like you have seen sieving at our homes also. So likewise, we have gels which have definite pore size to filter compounds based on their size. So those gels are used for size exclusion chromatography. Affinity chromatography, where specific interactions lead to binding of solute on your stationary phase. So like antigen-antibody interaction, it leads to binding of definite antibodies on the antigens, and which can later be eluted by changing pH or buffer. So these are mechanisms of separation based techniques. Then by utilizing all these chromatographic techniques, you can isolate components, purify them, analyze their purity. You can check whether these components are single pure components or mixture of components by HPLC or other GC methods. And then what you need to do is that you have to elucidate what you have isolated. Say you have isolated a powder material, powder compound, powder pure compound. You want to know what exactly is that powder pure compound. So for that, you need to perform spectroscopic experiments. So what spectroscopy is? Interaction of light with matter, which is used as an empirical. So what you can see is which is unseeable by naked eye. So you will see some spectrum, you will generate some spectrum, and those spectrum you can analyze. So here you can see the whole electromagnetic spectrum. X-ray is used to excite core electrons. So you excite core electrons and generate diffraction pattern. So X-ray diffraction pattern is generated, which is very unique for each crystal form. And then you get the crystal structure. UV is used to study UV excitation. IR is used to study vibrational states of the molecule, vibrational nature, stretching, bending, scissoring vibrations. Then radio waves are used in magnetic field to differentiate between nuclear spin states and their interaction. So nuclear spin states, when they are in a magnetic field, they orient themselves either in line to the magnetic field or against the magnetic field, and which generates a signal. Okay, and these signals are being transformed by our instruments, and then you get spectrum. Say this is one compound which has been isolated in our lab, You can see this is a diterpene. We prepared acetate of this type diterpene, and we analyzed it in an NMR. This is a typical proton NMR, 1H NMR. 1H is magnetically active nuclei, so you don't need, and its natural abundance is highest. So you don't need more amount of samples. Around 1 to 5 milligrams of sample is sufficient to achieve good quality spectrum like this. Okay, so all these signals, they belong to one or other proton in this molecule. Say this proton adjacent to this carbonyl and attached to this double bond is resonating over here, 5.913. Okay, likewise, all these protons belong to all these places. So to assign all these protons, then similarly you can have a 13C NMR, which is carbon NMR. So carbon NMR also gives you a spectrum like this. So here you can see all the 20 carbons, or in this case 24 carbons, because of these two acetate moieties, which are not part of this diterpene skeleton. Diterpene skeleton is only C20. So these two states constitute 4 carbons. So C24, all 24 carbons are being present on this NMR, very much separated. But their positions are different. You see some carbons are coming at around 170, 15, 104, 70, 69, 16, 18. So they are all giving us information about nature of these carbons. sp3, sp2, okay, carbonyl, aliphatic, aromatic. So these all methyl, CH2, these all we can distinguish from 13C and depth experiments. Likewise, there is a DP of Kozy experiment which tells about correlation between two protons. This proton is having a good coupling with a proton which is here. It means these two protons are adjacent to each other, or they are on the same carbon. Likewise, every proton, every coupling network you can identify from here. Coupling network means if you have a proton, two protons over here, two protons over here, two protons over here, but you don't have a proton at this carbon. So these three protons you can identify by coupling one. These two protons will couple with them. These two protons will couple with them as well as them. So you can identify. Similarly, this proton couples with a proton over here, CH2 over here, CH3 here. Then this CH will couple over here. This will couple with this CH2. There will be chain. If they are resolved enough, you can identify each and every coupling pattern. But if they are resolved, if they are close enough, you need further experimentation. Like we did gradient HSQC experiment. This experiment tells about the proton which is attached to that particular carbon. So you know, we know that which proton is attached to which carbon. Like this proton at around 5.8, you see this correlates to this carbon at around 112 or 15, somewhere like this. Okay, but this carbon is not correlating with any proton. It means this carbon is a quaternary carbon. Quaternary carbon means a carbon which is not having any, proton, like this one. Here we don't have a proton, so this comes like this. You don't have HSQC crossbond. So HSQC is one bond correlation. CH, if you draw a CH, so H couples with that particular carbon. You can see over here. So this is a gradient, so you can distinguish between a CH2 like this unfilled lobes, and then this filled lobes. Filled lobes are CHs and CH3s. Unfilled lobes, they are CH2s. So we can distinguish which carbons are CH2, which carbons are CH2. Then HMBC spectrum tells about remote couplings, like proton, this H will show HMBC with three carbons, one, two, three carbon over here, one, two, three carbon with this carbon. Likewise, all the CHs, all the protons over here, they show HMBC cross peaks. And these cross peaks are very helpful in assigning their position in this skeleton. So these all lead to unambiguous characterization of this molecule. Actually, we had two compounds. One compound is having beta orientation at this C12 position. You can see over here, this is beta. And if we have energy minimized structure, you can see the C12 is here. And this C15 is this lactone, this methane. This is in close proximity to CH370. This is a rosy spectrum, rotating over Hauser effect, NOE kind of a spectrum. Here you see this is that CH, and this CH is showing very clear-cut correlation with CH370. So, by this, we analyze that this acetate is oriented to beta. In another compound, we have this acetate or this hemiketal as alpha. And energy minimized conformation, if we calculate, it's this, where you have acetate as beta. And here, CH315 is not in close proximity to CH317 to show nuclear over Hauser effect. Actually, nuclear over Hauser effect you see when these peaks are around 5 ppm in space. So likewise, we have characterized them. Similarly, in another work, what we have done is that we have isolated these carbazole alkaloids from Moraya Konigi, that is curry patta. And these compounds have been characterized accordingly, and we have developed a process also for isolation of this coenidine compound. This coenidine was found to be active in our anti-diabetic assay, where we have tested it in DBDB mice and STZ mice followed by DBDB mice. So all these studies are published in this paper. What interesting observation we had is that earlier this mahanimbine was reported to be anti-diabetic active. So this was major compound in some collections. However, we have isolated this compound as a major component, and all these compounds belong to carbazoles. So we have a series of carbazoles, tested them, and we found out that mahanimbine is metabolically relatively unstable as compared to others. And that's how we prove that it's not only one compound which may have effect, it may be combination of more than one compounds which can show these effects. So these are students who have done this work. So I will not go into details. We have also proved this axial chirality in this molecule. You can see this is not a chiral molecule if you see with the eyes of a asymmetric carbon, but axial chirality is there. These two carbons, phenolics, they are attached to via CC bond, and there is a restricted rotation around this CC bond. That's why they are axially chiral, and we have proved it by CD spectroscopy and correlation with standard components. So these are all, here you can see the compound number 5, which is mahanimbine, is half-life is around 7.8 hours as compared to other compounds 2, 3, and 4. And that's why we have studied those compounds in STZ-induced diabetic rat model studies, followed by in vivo pharmacokinetics, where we have coenidine as suitable, which has a better Tmax, Cmax, and AUC. And further PP glucose tolerance and other studies were done. I will not go into details. These carbazole alkaloids are also anti-cancer, so we have also tested them. They were found to be active in breast cancer and prostate cancer. And they were modified. One of the compounds was isolated in more amount, two of these compounds actually, and they were modified at these R1, R2 and R3 positions. And some certain compounds with R2 modifications like this have shown very good efficacy in, as anti-cancer molecules. So these are, this is a slide which shows most of the components which are being isolated from several different plants and the publications coming out of them. So terpenoids, diterpenes, amino acid esters, flavonoids, then butanolides, abiosomycins, alkaloids. So these are the class of compounds which we have been pursuing. I'll not go into details of phytopharmaceuticals as botanical drugs because we have already discussed. There is a guideline, a gazette notification 2015, which says that purified standardized fraction defined minimum 4 bioactive or phytochemical compounds. These preparations can be subjected to phytopharmaceuticals regulation and approval. So this is basic information what are required for phytopharmaceuticals. So all the clinical and human clinical and pharmacological background information, basic information about plant, identification, authentication, source of plant used for extraction and fraction. This is very important to keep track of different sorts of impurities and seasonal and geographical variations, process of extraction, substituted fractionation, formulation, manufacturing process of formulation, stability data, safety and pharmacology information, then starts human phase clinical trials, confirmatory clinical trials, regulatory status and marketing. So I would like to give you a brief account of CDRI. CDRI is involved in discovery, target-based mechanistic studies, preclinical and clinical evaluation. CDRI's toxicology and pharmacology is GLP accredited, and we are testing. So this is a normal flow chart we follow for plant-based research collection based on botanical authentication, extraction, fractionation based on solvent and other techniques, biocidal separation we do, and then analyze them in different biological evaluation. We isolate active compounds, then lead generation, marker isolation, and standard generation of standard markers. Then it goes into drug development, preclinical safety pharmacology, and Ayush or phytopharmaceutical products are being developed. So you know, alpha beta RT ether, EMAL is CDRI's achievement, where RT mesylene was converted selectively to alpha beta RT ether. And RT ether, and these RT ether is marketed as EMAL, and which is marketed in India, in African countries also. So most of these products, they are made based on CDRI technology. Memory enhancer Becocytes were standardized in Becopamoniarin, and this is BESEB or KeenMind Memory Sure. This is product from CDRI. Google lipids from Coppiferum vitae. These Google stones have been isolated, EMZ, and they're found to be effective in cholesterol lowering, cholesterol and triglyceride lowering, and they're marketed to Cipla. Picrolib, again, Picroriza corua. It's again revisited in the wake of phytopharmaceuticals guidelines. So it's a product which is of very high value in the wake of new use of these old studies. This product was also available for use. Recently, reunion and joint fresh nutraceutical supplements have been developed for fracture healing and bone health. This is from Spinacea olivacea, Pollock, and this is from Delbertia sisuplan. So these are all drugs developed since independence, new drugs developed since independence in India, and these marked in yellow, you can see they are from Syria, right? So 13 out of these 20 are developed from CSIR Syria. So at the end slide, phytochemicals, basically we target them to develop towards development of drugs. They help us understanding diseases. They help us identify new targets and rational design based on those targets. They help us new delivery systems, formulations, generation of new avenues in these lines. Thank you very much. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah. So I'm done, Megha. So I think if there are any questions, so shall I stop sharing?
Yeah, sure, sir. So students, and now the floor is open for your queries discussion. So please go ahead.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I want to know about the professor, sir, UU24 Nobel Prize, and yeah. And she was replaced the sir ethanol. Their boiling point is 78 degrees centigrade, and she was replaced the ether in place of in ethanol. So for the extraction process and the stability of the sir ingredients, sir. So, sir, I want to know, sir, what can change, sir, in the replace of ether? I mean, sir, both menstruum, ethanol or ether are both menstruum, and both can capable the extraction in the extraction process and take the constituent outside, sir. So, sir, I want to know what is the what can change the ether in place of the ethanol, sir? Because ether have the 35 degree centigrade and boiling point, and ethanol have the 78 degree centigrade. So, sir, both the capable of the extraction process, no, sir, as menstruum.
Menstruum means what? I didn't understand.
Menstruum, I mean, sir, solvent which was used, like ethanol and ether, as menstruum.
Actually, what is difference between ethanol and Diethyl ether is comparatively non-polar medium as compared to ethanol. Okay, ethanol is a polar medium for isolation of the compound. However, they don't differ too much in their nature of extraction to these Artemis names. What happens if you extract with ethanol? Most of the extractives you obtain, they obtain by refluxing ethanol extraction. They extracted these compounds in ethanol. And ultimately, you have to remove ethanol out of your extract, even if you do cold percolation. Okay?
Yes, yes.
You can have cold percolation. Percolate means you stay your material in ethanol for several hours, repeat it, you will collect say 10 liters, 20 liters of ethanol extract, and that 20 liters of ethanol you are again going to concentrate. Okay?
Yes, yes.
Because whole extract comes in that solvent. So 20, 25 liters of solvent you are collecting by extracting cold percolation method. And then this solvent again you are going to concentrate, means you will evaporate this solvent. So for evaporation, if you want to evaporate ethanol, you need to give heat. Okay, if you have very efficient rotary evaporator, even then you need at least 45 degrees temperature and a vacuum, okay, to remove that ethanol. And it will take longer time. So that heat which is given to evaporate this solvent system, this extract, to concentrate this extract, was not suitable for trioxanes, trioxane moiety of this Artemis. and this trypsin moiety gets degraded. So active pharmacophore is getting degraded. So what will happen? Say 20% of these trioxanes are degraded. 20, 30, 40% whatsoever. It depends on how long you subjected it to that temperature. If you have extracted it by reflux, it is going to degrade most of the components. If you have just evaporated under reduced pressure, evaporated, however, not under reduced pressure, then again you will not have enough material in hand, enough trioxanes in hand. If you have even if you have reduced, concentrated it on reduced vacuum, reduced pressure and minimum temperature of 45 degrees, even then you are not going to get 100% recovery of trioxanes. So your concentration of trioxanes is going to be lowered. And that's why there was not consistency in the data of extract activity at that time. That's what you need to observe, that every time she make extracts and analyze them for their antimalarial activity, every time this activity is different. Okay, it's just because we cannot maintain exact conditions every time if we are not having certain automated systems. 1972, she did it. So in 1972, they must have used traditional equipments, not like what we use today. I hope you get it.
Okay.
But
yes,
with
sir.
Ether, what is possible is that you just cold percolate it.
Okay.
And even if you keep ether open, it will evaporate.
Yes, definitely, sir.
Okay. 35 degrees. So that's how she can get pure artemisinins in major amount required for the activity. And that's how artemisinin concentration increased many fold in the extract, which led to 100% suppression of paracetamol in her in vivo experiments. I hope it's clear to you.
Yes, sir. Yes, thank you, sir. And sir, second, I thought, sir. And sir, why imbibition apart from the imbibition, sir? Why imbibition is necessary before packing of the drug into the percolator, sir? If the I directly drug packed in the percolator, so in this case, why need the imbibition before the sir packing in the percolator, sir?
No, I didn't understand your question. Can you repeat it once?
Yes, sir. Why imbibition is necessary before packing of the drug into the percolator, sir?
Packing of drug in percolator?
Yes, sir. Percolators is also a source of the sir extraction process in the percolator, sir. Percolator is also a device, sir. Last layer,
yeah,
sir.
Percolator. Yes, sir. In percolator, what we do, we pack our shed grinded plant material. Okay, so say you have a leaf, you grind it properly and then pack it in that percolator and then dip it under desired solvent to extract, make extract.
Okay.
Is it?
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Hello, graphene. You break these cells or break this tissue level, these plant materials at tissue level, they won't be very easy. It won't be very easy to get all these secondary metabolites in the solvent, extracted in the solvent. So that's why you need to grind them and make them into pieces before you extract.
Okay,
slow.
Yes, Nilanshu, you have a question?
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, this is Nilanshu Gaurav from Bansal Institute, Lucknow.
Mm-hmm.
Sir, my question is like, how long should be a dried plant material extracted, which is extracted in chloroform or hexane, be stable?
It depends on your storage conditions, because you will definitely concentrate them on rotary evaporator under reduced pressure and optimum temperature. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So once you dry them, vacuum dry them to release most of the moisture and all, you can keep them under refrigerator condition.
Like when I put it in 4 degrees Celsius, how long it be stable?
It depends. Like if you are dealing with trioxane plants, they won't be stable enough. So stability, I have mentioned in one of my slides regarding regulatory requirements for phytopharmaceuticals. There, what you have to do is that, say you have four marker compounds. You have identified four marker compounds, which is prerequisite for development of phytopharmaceuticals. So you will be doing stability of all these four markers separated and along with the product. Say your product is a fraction or a extract. So you will study stability of these markers in extract as well as their stability as individual components. Okay. So stability means you will subject it to moisture conditions, you will subject it to humid conditions, acidic, basic, and all. So accelerated stability has a protocol in pharmaceutics. So they study under different conditions the stability of those components. So say components are stable till 6 months under normal humid conditions. If they are not stable, so they need to be kept away from moisture. So this will be a direction on your product, that this product should not be kept in open, or yes, should be kept away from heat, kept away from direct sunlight.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So storage requirements are decided based on these stability studies.
Thank you, sir.
Any more questions?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, one clarification, sir, regarding my sir academic, sir. So can I ask you, sir?
Yeah, definitely.
Sir, can I tell in Hindi, sir? Are you comfortable?
I'm very much comfortable.
Yes, okay. Thank you, sir. Sir, jaisa ki sir, main bhi MSc sir kar raha hoon is care se, CSIR Laboratory, New Delhi se jo hai, sir. सो सर फर्दर सर एमएससी कंप्लीट होने के बाद जो मेरा डिसिप्लिन है सर वो तो सर मेरा साइंस कम्युनिकेशन एंड इंफॉर्मेशन रिसोर्सेज से है जिसमें कि हम ये रिसर्च जर्नलिस्ट वगैरह सब पे मेरा थेसिस सबमिट होगा जब प्रोजेक्ट स्टार्ट होगी तो सर क्या मैं जैसे CDRI में PhD के लिए अप्लाई करूँगा तो सर कंसिडर होगा एक्चुअली सर मैंने और एक फैकल्टी थे मैंने उनसे पूछा था फिर भी मुझे अभी डाउट है कुछ प्रोजेक्ट को लेकर के सर तो सर मैं आपसे थोड़ा क्लेरिफिकेशन चाहता हूँ क्योंकि सर जो मेरे बैचलर का जो कोर सब्जेक्ट है वो फार्मेसी ही है मैंने बी फॉर्म किया है तो सर एमएससी होने के बाद मैं चाहता हूँ कि CDRI में जो कि वो फार्मेसी औषधि अनुसंधान केंद्र है तो सर मैं उसमें PhD के लिए अप्लाई करूंगा तो सर मेरा प्रोजेक्ट से रिलेटेड क्या कोरिलेशन होगा सर वहाँ पर मेरा
एक्चुअली आपका एक्सपर्टीज जो है वो आपका जो अभी एक्सपर्टाइज है वो किस में है अभी जो आप एमएससी कर रहे हैं ना अभी आप
यस 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 सर
तो आपके सब्जेक्ट क्या हैं
वो सर साइंस कम्युनिकेशन है सर वो
साइंस कम्युनिकेशन है तो साइंस कम्युनिकेशन अगर आपका एमएससी में सब्जेक्ट है
यस सर
तो एक्चुअली PhD जो होता है वो एमएससी के सब्जेक्ट से डिटेक्ट होते हैं
यस यस सर
बायोलॉजी में अगर आपने एमएससी किया है तो मोस्टली आप बायोलॉजिकल साइंसेज से PhD करते हैं ऐसा कोई कंपलसरी नहीं है कि अगर आपने बायोलॉजिकल साइंस में एमएससी किया है तो सिर्फ बायोलॉजिकल साइंस में ही PhD कर सकते हैं आप कोई भी सब्जेक्ट ऑप्ट कर सकते हैं PhD के लिए ठीक है लेकिन जो रिक्वायरमेंट है जैसे CDRI में PhD के लिए आपको नेट क्वालिफाइड होना चाहिए.
यस 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 डेफिनेटली
जीआरएफ फेलोशिप आपके पास होनी
चाहिए. यस यस सर. यस सर.
तो जीआरएफ अगर आप केमिकल साइंसेज में हैं ठीक
यस यस
तब आप हमारे डिपार्टमेंट में पीएचडी कर सकते हैं. जीआरएफ अगर आप बायोलॉजिकल साइंसेज से हैं तो आपको बायोलॉजिकल साइंस में पीएचडी करनी होगी.
अगर सर मैं यूजीसी नेट क्वालिफाई करता हूं सर तो
नेट इज एलिजिबिलिटी फॉर लेक्चरशिप ओनली. अगर सर जीआरएफ आप है आपके पास है
यस सर
तभी आप पीएचडी के लिए.
यस यस सर डेफिनेटली सर.
हमारे इंस्टीट्यूट में बहुत सारे इंस्टीट्यूट्स की अपनी अलग फेलोशिप है. You can opt over there, you can apply, you can appear for the interview and then get selected for PhD programs in different institutes, universities and all. They also accept NET qualification because they have institutional fellowships to support PhD.
Yes, yes, sir. So, sir, means ye hua ki, sir, main eligible hoon. Agar main, sir, UGC NET, agar JRF qualify karta hoon, either CSIR, NET qualify karta hoon.
Science communication mein, I think you have to inquire because CDRI mein science communication kaha kuch kaam to nahi, aisa nahi hota hai.
Yes, yes, sir.
Mostly papers publish karte hain. We do all this communication job ourselves.
Yes, yes, sir.
And, but IPR cell is there. IP cell, where if you have some experience in IP, intellectual property rights, then okay, you may contact them and ask if you are suitable to do PhD in IP.
At CDRI, sir, no?
Yeah.
Okay, sir. And sir, ek aur sir query hai, sir. Sir, upcoming ek sir skill development program ek sir aane wali hai January mein, hmm, jo apply hogi. तो उसमें तो सर अप्लाई कर सकता हूँ सर स्किल डेवलपमेंट के लिए. जैसे ये सर जैसे उसमें ड्रग डिलीवरी सिस्टम ये सब से भी है उसमें टॉपिक.
हाँ नहीं बहुत सारे स्किल डेवलपमेंट प्रोग्राम से भी आ रही ऑर्गेनाइज कर रहा था. कोरोना की वजह से अभी कुछ फिजिकल नहीं हो रहा था लेकिन अब शायद हो पाएगा. अभी
वी
आर कॉन्फिडेंट कि आगे इम्प्रूव होगी सिचुएशन तो फिजिकल ट्रेनिंग जो है वो हो पाएगी.
ओके
आप इंक्वायर कर लीजिएगा एक बार बिफोर यू अप्लाई. जैसे ही जो भी नोटिफिकेशन आएगा इस इंफॉर्मेशन के साथ आएगा कि उसमें किस तरीके का प्रोग्राम होगा.
यस सर. अभी तो सर सिर्फ अभी आ रहा है अपकमिंग जनवरी से अप्लाई के लिए.
हाँ
अच्छा ठीक है. एडवर्टाइजमेंट सर मैं देख लूंगा एक बार इंक्वायरी कर लूंगा सर.
श्योर.
ओके थैंक यू सर. थैंक्स अ लॉट सर.
ओके
So students, if you have any query or if you want to ask about CDRI or anything related to phytochemicals, anything, if you are doing any dissertation and you want input from sir, then I think he would be happy to do that.
So Dr. Megha.
Yes, sir.
So these students who have attended these talks and this webinar series, we are going to pursue some projects at SISTI or some of them apply over there.
Yes, sir. So, sir, the idea is to, the mandate of BEES actually is the residential workshop to provide the mentorship and to enable them to think differently and to pursue their entrepreneurial journey through their idea. And basically the validation of grassroots practices. You might be aware about the Srishti's work that we are documenting grassroots practices. So sir, actually we are inviting students for hands-on training every year 3 times. But this time due to pandemic, we have organized this webinar to provide the mentorship before when the situation improves, they come here for hands-on training. So later when the situation improves, we'll invite them for short training and then out of 50 or 60 students, we will select 10 best projects or 10 best student for 1 lakh rupees grant. Yeah, so they can carry that work at their laboratories or if they are not well that facility, then they come here in Srishti's lab and then they can do that work.
Okay, thank you.
So students, I hope you have no queries.
No, ma'am.
Sir, thank you so much for your time. And I didn't know about your connection with the Srishti, but now I realize one DST project, or you were saying that I think there were 8 actinomycetes, actiogen, antimicrobial.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Right. So I have seen that report here.
Yeah, actually, sometimes it's very tough to convey to funding agency that how tough it is to isolate this compound.
Right, sir.
Again, if it is from microbes, bacteria, what happens from 25 liters of culture of bacteria, you get few grams or milligrams of extract.
Right, sir.
And that few grams, milligrams of extract, if somebody else is making for you, for a for a chemist, means it is not controlled at my end.
Right.
So that amount is controlled by fermentation person. So it's very tough then to isolate compounds, because many a times we are not successful in isolating compounds. Many a times we have to change state several times before we achieve that isolated stuff. And even if it is less than 5 milligram of compound, pure compound, it's very tough to characterize in our country.
Right. So, sir, have you studied any antiviral compounds? Have you focused on that?
Actually, I'm working on Trinospora pedifolia, but not for antiviral effect. But it's well known, and people are working on Trinospora pedifolia for as an antiviral.
Yes, because right now everybody is, you know, focusing on antiviral drug or some active compounds which can be used for this pandemic situation. Just out of curiosity.
Yeah, because there are many plants, Ayurvedic plants, they are found effective in antiviral, or per se, corona, COVID-19, against COVID-19 virus. So they are being used. However, clinical evidences and these all, it may take more time to come.
Right, sir.
So Ayurvedic preparations people can use, and they are definitely using, actually, as per the guidelines of ministry, Ayush ministry. People are consuming them, but little precaution needs to be taken before you consume a lot of these Ayurvedic stuff.
I'm in contact with NITM director, Dr. Deep Chattopadhyay, sir. NITM director. And we wrote one collaborative project, me and sir, and submitted to CSIR and BIREC. They have not screened yet, I think. But that was on a medicinal plant. So thank you so much, sir, for your time, and really happy to have you on the session, and we always look forward for your contribution and support for this future workshop. And thank you so much, sir, once again.
Sure, I will be able to. Thank you very much for connecting me to this platform.
Pleasure, sir.
Okay, convey my regards to
Anil, sir. Okay. Sure, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Bye, sir. Have a good day.
Okay, thank you very much. Bye-bye, all of you.
Thank you, sir.